feel so.
Shall we put our hands together and we can
Jewish people, as they celebrate the new year, by the way, is year 5778. This is the new year. So happy new year, everybody. You didn't know it was the new year. And the symbol for the new year, the symbol that they use, the Hebrew letter that they use, is the symbol for gate. And so we are entering a doorway, a new gate. We're entering a new season. And what you saw, what you felt during worship time is something very new. And maybe some of you felt a little bit, oh, this is different. This is not usual. We don't usually do this. This is different. I'm going to have to think about this, perhaps. And I would just right now say, in order to move ahead into things of God, we have to enter these new gates. A new season, and receive and embrace the intimacy that God wants to have with us. Do you want intimacy with God, or just a distant relationship? Intimacy or distant relationship? Intimacy. Well, intimacy means you have to open up the private parts. And so this is what he's calling us to do. And he does want to touch us. I love the songs that we sang during worship. But he is the potter, we are the clay. We need to be formed. Are you formable? Is your clay soft enough for him to move it and shape it? Or is it hard? Because if it's hard, he's going to take that lump, and he's going to put it in the water for a long time in order for it to soften. If your heart is soft right now, he says, yes, Lord, my heart is soft to you. Come, touch me, touch my heart. Shape me, mold me into what you want out of me. And he does want to touch you. He wants it, but he can also touch a hard heart and work you into a soft lump. So I pray that your lump of clay would be soft so you can act quickly, more quickly. So I know, anyways, I want to take you to the very beginning because I think it's very important that you understand the dimensions that we are walking in. You are more than three dimensions. There's more to you than you know. And this is even scientifically proven that there's more to you than what you can feel, taste, see, and you move. You move in spiritual realms. We're not even aware of it, but the Bible tells us that we are even seated with Christ in heavenly places. This is not a future. It's not a future thought. It's a thing happening right now. But anyways, to understand, I want to take you back to the garden. Since this is the year of the gate, and we know that when Adam and Eve were chased out of the garden, were told to leave, there was an angel there at the gate to protect us from coming back into the Garden of Eden. But I want to take you back. So let's go back into the garden, and let's go back into time, and let's look at what the Bible says about us, about man. He said two things at the very beginning, and those two things were, be fruitful and multiply. Those are the two things that he wanted Adam and Eve to do, to be fruitful and to multiply. And those things have been happening. But we need to understand, what is fruitfulness? What is fruitfulness? Are you fruitful? Are you fruitful? Are you multiplying? Well, I feel that we need to know that God is interested in what we do. Okay? He is interested in our doing. And he's also interested in the fact that we also need to multiply. He's interested in more than, in mathematical terms, he's been more interested in multiplication than addition and subtraction. But often we just move in the addition and subtraction mode, and we look at a balance sheet. This is a plus, 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 it's a minus, 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 and we try to always be on the plus side. Isn't that right? Isn't that why we have balance sheets? We always want to be on the plus side. But he says, no, I don't want you to move in the plus and the minus. I want you to move into the multiplication. He wants to multiply. And so we're in the garden, and we're moving in the garden, and there's many trees in the garden. And I believe that those trees, the Bible says they were trees that had fruit and had seeds. And so we know that seeds is a whole thing that has to do with multiplication. And so I believe that these trees in the Bible in the garden had very special qualities. Okay, I don't think that they just ate the trees because of the fruit because they tasted good. I'm sure it had a very good taste, but I think something supernatural happened when they ate of certain trees, fruit of certain trees. And we know that there are fruit, even today, there are trees that produce fruit that really blesses our body. For example, orange trees, a lot of vitamin C. And vitamin C is good for your health. And other trees that have fruit that produce other things. There's a lot of plants that bless us in our bodies. But in the garden, I believe the trees had supernatural powers. And the reason I say that is because they were because of that one tree, that very, very important tree of the fruit, that if you ate of this fruit, you would be empowered with the knowledge of good and evil. The Lord says, do not eat that fruit. And of course, we know that we did. Adam and Eve did. And by man came death. But by man came also the resurrection. And so let's go with Eve. Eve, by the way, was created not out of the clay, but out of the side of Adam. She was meant to be his helper. Mate. That is a very, very important thing to remember about the creation of Eve. She was to be Adam's helpmate. And it's I want to talk about Eve because she did a good job. I think, how many people think Eve did a good job? I think she did a good job. I'm for Eve. I'm for Eve. I think Eve has had a bad rap. You know, she's been, people have been pointing up to her. She's, oh, she's the color, she's the reason of the fall and all that. I can just imagine Eve, you know, she's Adam's helper, and Adam, you know, his job was to name the animals. You know, that was his job. He loved to do that. And here comes a galloping animal. Wow, I know, I'm going to call that a horse! And I could see Eve tapping his shoulder. Adam, that's a stallion. Oh, okay. And Eve all the time would be correcting Adam, you know? And so she was a good helper, I'm sure. And that's where a man learned to say, yes, honey. Yes, you're right, honey. And so she's really out there. She's really, really a good helper. But, you know, Adam really has to, yeah, okay. Mm-hmm. And this time, but Eve is before the tree of knowledge of good and evil. And I want to ask you some questions, okay? And I always like to interact with my people when I speak. And so I'm going to ask, does God want good things for you?
Yes.
Yes. How many agree? If you agree that God wants to give us good things, lift up your hand. If you don't agree, put your hand up now. Okay, you all agree. Good. God wants to give us good things. Amen?
Amen.
Oh, come on. Amen?
Amen.
All right. And God wants to give us beautiful things. How many of you believe that God loves beauty? Just a few of you. Okay. If you believe that God doesn't like beauty, lift up your hand. He loves beautiful things. That's why he created Eve. That's why he created man. That's why you're here. Look at you. You are beautiful people. God loves beauty. Absolutely. So he loves beauty. Look at the beautiful sunsets he creates, the mountains, everything, even the jewels. Sri Lanka is famous for its jewels. You are the most beautiful jewels of Sri Lanka. Did you know that? Right here, right in this room. You're the most beautiful jewels, beautiful creation. Do you think that God wants you to be wealthy? Yeah, I think so. He wants, wealthy is not just money, folks. Wealth and wisdom is wealth. Did you know Proverbs 7 says wisdom is wealth? And so he wants you to be wise, he wants you to be intelligent, he wants all these good things. So, like I said, I believe that Eve was on the right track, okay, when she's in front of this tree of knowledge of good and evil. And I want to go over what is happening with Eve in front of the tree of knowledge of good and evil. We know that she was deceived. I don't have to tell you the conversation that she was having with that serpent. But what was going through Eve's head as she's looking at the fruit? All right. So I'm quoting out of Genesis 3:6, the three elements of temptation. What tempted Eve? Number one. So when the woman saw that the tree was good for food. Oh, that's this fruit. She's looking at the fruit. Oh. She's tasting it. Tastes good. It's good. This is a good fruit. Hey, Adam! It's a good fruit. It's good. Tastes really good. Tastes really good. So it's good. Do you think God wants us to have good things? If it was bad, she would spit it out. Too sour, or whatever. So, that was the first thing. She saw that it was good. Second thing she saw. Wow, look at this, Adam. Look how beautiful it is. It's beautiful. It was a delight to the eyes. That's what the Bible says. It's delightful. How many people like delightful things? I do. I like beautiful things. I delight in beauty. It's beautiful. I delight in it. So two things. It's good. It's delightful. It's beautiful. Nothing wrong with that. How many agree? Come on. Yeah. Nothing wrong with that. Team, you're doing a good job. You're really identifying correctly. There's nothing wrong with your discernment there. And she said, it says, it was to be desired to make one wise. Well, how many people want to be wise here? I do. I want wisdom. I want wisdom because I want wealth. I want to be rich. I want to be wise. I want to be like Solomon. I want to make good decisions. Those three things are good. There's nothing wrong with them. If I was Eve, I'd believe those three things are good, beautiful, and wise. Therefore, I'm going to eat that fruit. What's wrong with this decision? It's disobedience. Disobedience is the problem. Not the quality of the fruit. The fruit, whatever it is before us, is not the problem. The problem is disobedience. And brothers and sisters, we are walking in a season where we will need to be more and more obedient. We need to be taught to be obedient. So, just because something is good, or just because something is beautiful, or even if it's a wise, seemingly a wise thing to do, it doesn't give you the license to be disobedient. This is a very, very important lesson. It does not. We cannot do something for those reasons, because we must walk in obedience. Let's look, and this is what caused the downfall of man. And I want to take you, I want to jump ahead to the book of Joshua, okay? The people of Israel were walking in the desert. They come out of the desert, they cross the Jordan, and they go into the promised land. And their first challenge is the city of Jericho. And so the Lord says, okay, go ahead. I'm going to give you the victory. However, I don't want you to take anything out of that city. I want you to burn everything. Do not take anything. The silver and the gold and the bronze and all these things you can take for me. They are called devoted things, okay? But everything else, destroy, destroy, destroy. And we know that the victory of Jericho was done by the trumpets and walking around the wall. We know the story, except for one thing. Maybe we have forgotten that there was one person who disobeyed. His name was Achan. And Achan saw something. Oh, he saw something beautiful. Oh, a beautiful coat from Shinar, wherever that is. But it must have been expensive, and it must have been beautiful, and pleasing to the eye. He must have thought, I'm not going to burn this. This is beautiful. Look at the stitching. Look at the work. Look at the embroidery. Look. And it smells beautiful. It's, I can smell the spices from far away. And it's just the perfume. It's so perfumed. And so one day, I'm going to pull that out and I'm going to wear it. It's going to give me status. So he takes it and he brings it to his house. The other thing he finds is gold. Gold and silver. He says, whoa, this is power. This is good. Gold and silver, I'm going to keep, there's lots have gone into for the Lord, but I'm just going to keep some because I don't know what's ahead in this promised land, but I know that if I have a little bit of gold and silver, if I have a little bit of that security, I'll be better off. So he takes the gold and the silver, and so he's doing these things. What is motivating his thinking is stinking thinking. Stinking thinking will get you in trouble. Okay? All the reasons that he's giving are good reasons. And these, God does not want to withhold the good things from you, but he is thinking like Eve was thinking. She saw that it was good to eat. He saw that it was good. It was good. It's beautiful. It was beautiful. The fruit is beautiful. Here, that beautiful robe is beautiful. And the gold will give me power to be wise, and it'll give me status, and I'll be able to, I'll have some security. And so he takes it. What's his problem? Disobedience. And his sin is found out. And I always felt so bad for Achan, because not only did he get stoned to death, but his family also, and his animals, and they were burnt. Everything was burnt. That was the consequence. And I felt, oh my gosh, where's mercy? Where's mercy? Where are you, Lord? Why don't you just give him a chance? I mean, that was bad, you know, taking all these things. Like, the robbery is bad. But can't you give him a chance? Did you ever ask that question when you were reading that? I did. I said, God, why can't you give him a chance? Because I've disobeyed in the past, and I do that once in a while also. I must confess I disobey. But God gives me a chance. Why can't you give Achan a chance? He wants to give you a chance. Have you disobeyed recently, anybody? Would you care to admit it? Yeah, look at honest people. The rest of you are all good. Just two people have disobeyed. That's pretty good. This is a good church. How many have disobeyed recently? Come on. There's some honest people. Thank you. But, you know, God, he's not going to stone you. He's not going to stone your family. He's not going to destroy your possessions. You know why? Because he took it upon himself. Jesus took that upon himself. He took the punishment. So we're given the example of Eve, and we're given the example of Achan. And I want to show you the amazing truth that I stumbled upon. I love stumbling upon truths in the Bible. And I found an amazing truth. And it was found... Well, let's just look again. I had this in my notes, and I should share it with you. About Achan's things. He said, "When I saw among the spoils a beautiful cloak from Shinar, which sounds pleasing, the good silver gold buying power, usefulness, and he desired them and coveted them for himself, seeing that it was maybe a wise thing to do. But the Lord says, and this is the key that I found, do not be conformed to this age, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind." And this is the word that I want to leave with you today. Do not be conformed. Where's your citizenship? Where's your citizenship? You know what? How many people here believe? Do you believe? Do you really believe in Jesus? If you believe in Jesus, stand up. You really believe? One lady here. Don't believe? Oh, okay. Oh, you believe. Lift up your hand. That's good. I'm among believers here. Good. All right. How many people are really, really convinced? Ah, you can sit down. You believe, but some of us need to be convinced. We need convincing. Okay? We say we believe, but we need convincing. This is where Holy Spirit comes. You know, Eve was created why? To be what? What was her destiny? To be the helpmate. You know what you have? You do have a helpmate. Whether you're a woman or a man, you have a helper. You know who that helper is? Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit is your helper. God created you, but he's also sent you, the Holy Spirit, to be your helper. Because we cannot be conformed. We cannot move out of this age. We cannot be transformed without the renewing of our mind. And we're entering, like I said, the new gate, a new season. And this morning as I was preparing to leave and I was praying for this moment, I saw the gate. And I saw that as we walk through the gate, each one of you, as we walk through this gate, this new year, this new season, that God had gifts at the gate. He had a welcome gift. How many people love welcome gifts? I love welcome gifts. I love it. People say, welcome, welcome, here's a gift for you. We're so glad you came. Wow, for me, what a blessing. You honor me with a gift. Well, this is what I felt and I saw in the Spirit for each one of you. How many people want a welcome gift? None of you. One, two, three. A welcome gift. Would you like a welcome gift? Yes! Would you like one? Would you like... Brad, do you want a welcome gift? All right. Good. Well, I believe that the Spirit has a welcome gift for you this morning. Welcome. Welcome through. Those who walk into the new things of God will get a welcome gift. I believe that this is for today. Now, let's look. And I'll tell you, the things that Eve wanted, the things that Achan wanted, they were not bad things. I believe that God wants to give us this. And this is where I found the fact that he does. He says, do not be conformed to this age, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Why? Why do we need our mind renewed with the help of the Holy Spirit? So that you may discern what is good, what is pleasing, what is the perfect will of God. The same three things. The same three things that Eve was looking for, that Achan was looking for, that we are looking for. But we need discernment. We need to have our mind transformed. So do not walk in the thinking of this world in disobedience. We need to walk in obedience so that we can receive the good, that we may discern. Yes, that is good, but I'm not supposed to do that, so I'm not going to do that. Oh, this is good. This is really from God. I'm going to move in that. So we need to discern. You see, we need the mind of Christ. And we need, what is pleasing? Don't you just want to please God? You know what he says of Jesus? He says, this is my son with whom I am well pleased. This is what he's saying to you. Did you know that he says that to you? Because you are carrying Jesus. Because you have asked Jesus. You are not walking in the flesh. You are in this world, but not of this world. You are a citizen of heaven. And so you need to start thinking like the citizenship. Where is your citizenship? All right? And so perfect will of God is perfect wisdom, is perfect wealth. God wants to bless you. And so let's welcome this new week, this new day, the first of this week, and walking into the new gates, the new season, and walk into the blessings that God has for each and every one of us. Amen? And don't forget to pick up your welcome gift. Don't leave without your welcome gift. And I want to pray for you. And if you feel that you are far from God, that you need to come closer, I want to pray for you. Because you know what? God sees you from afar. Because when the father was looking at prodigal son, he said he saw his son from afar. And maybe you feel that you've been a little bit far from God. I'll tell you one thing. He's not going to wait. He's going to start running towards you. So don't feel that you will be left behind, because God is eager to find you. Don't be afraid. Don't hide. Adam and Eve tried to hide, and I'll be talking about that at camp. And don't hide, okay? So right now, let's have Brad and Marguerite come up, and they're going to minister in music. And I really believe in the prophetic. I believe that God, the Spirit of God, moves. Yes, take it. Take the mic. Okay, all right. Shaketa Masanisha. Do you have time? Do you want to go? If you want to go, you can leave now. You can leave now. You may leave. I'll dismiss you right now in the name of Jesus. Go and be blessed. But if you want more, stick around, because it's going to get better. It's going to get better. Who wants more? More? A little bit more? Sure. You, I'm going to talk to you. Would you stand up? Okay. I believe that you really are wanting more in your life. And I think that sadness has held you back. There's a lot of things that have happened in your life that is holding you back. But your eyes really want more of Jesus. You want solutions. And I want to let you know that God has got your number. His eyes are on you. His eyes are on you. He has not forgotten you. And He loves you. I want you to know that He loves you. And you're totally forgiven. And you know what? He says, please forgive those that hurt you. Please forgive those that hurt you, because you will receive my forgiveness. And more than that, you will receive his glory. He will straighten your path. You have not got, you're not far from him. He is very close to you, and he will straighten your path. He will make things right. And he will, you see, there's lots of, you're seeing lots of different solutions. But he says, I am the only solution for you. I am the only way. I am your life. I am your path. And he's going before you. He will go before you and make a way where you don't even know the ways. All your solutions, all the things that you have thought, they're going to fall off to the side, and the road will become very, very straight. He will answer your prayers. His eyes are on you. I just see that for you. Amen. You over there, lady. Yeah, would you stand up? I believe that God is going to give you divine leading. You're going to be able to see things. You're going to be able to discern things in the Spirit as you walk, as you continue to walk in faith. I believe that the Spirit will guide you in decision. The Spirit will show you things, and that he will give you that discernment that you need to get the good, the beauty, and the wisdom. I think that you're walking in that direction right now. And just watch. In the next few days, you're going to realize there's going to be, you're going to get revelation, revelation after revelation. I think you're going to be moving in revelation in your life. Amen. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord. We just love your gifts, Lord. You are the author and finisher of our faith. Thank you. Just receive from the Lord right now. He knows your heart.